And now, weighing in out of the blue corner, Josh the Pong Thompson.
100%.
And on the other mic, he weighs in from the red corner, Big Sean McCarthy.
Well, hello to everyone. It is late at night or early in the morning. I don't care which one you want to call it, but UFC 302 has just ended with Islam Makhachev retaining his lightweight title against the Diamond, Dustin Poirier. It was a hell of a fight. We had a big heavyweight fight also that took place. We'll talk about that. There's all kinds of things to talk about that are going on. And my man, the real punk.
I'm looking great, man. Looking great as
Joshua!
Man. So I didn't tell John, but I did a little live reaction. Did you know about that, John? Did you see it? Okay. I did a little live reaction on YouTube for the co-main and the main event. Keto George and I were playing around with it. We wanted to see how it all worked out. So we'll invite you next time, John.
So how did it all work out?
I don't know. I mean, we had I don't know how many people we had, when we first started off about 40 seconds in, we had about 100 people on. So that worked out okay. And then I don't know if it grew or what it was, but we went through the co-main, 250. All right, that's not bad. I didn't announce it until the main card started. I said, hey, you know what? I decided because it's Islam tonight and Dustin can't miss that fight, I'm going to go ahead and give a live reaction while we're doing this. So I was like, yeah, let's just check it out.
So hold on. So what was your reactions?
I was a lot better this time. You know, than the Khabib fight with Justin Gaethje. That fight was a disaster.
Yeah, because I was there for that one. It was a disaster.
But with him, with Khabib, it was hard for me because he like refused to shoot. Like at least I knew in Islam's mind, the end goal was to try to get the takedown.
Yeah.
And with Khabib, it was like, I was like, you just didn't know. We had Javier on here just recently. And he's like, you know, I told him sometimes to do this and do that. He just did what he wanted. You think I wanted him to stand that long?
Always.
No.
Always.
He just did what he wanted. John, I got to be honest. You know, we're working with a new sponsor, BetUS.
BetUS, America's favorite sportsbook and casino. Live betting and racebook. We're celebrating 30 years with a historic offer. A 125% sign-up bonus on your first three deposits. Plus, 10% gambler's insurance. Get started today. BetUS, where the game begins.
How did your picks go? Who did you pick? And I'm going to tell you, I picked my parlay, but who did you pick?
I picked, one of the things I picked was the over in the Islam versus Poirier fight, which obviously it went over.
Yeah,
that was a plus 160, so that paid off very well. I didn't win. I went with Paulo Costa because it was so far at plus 210 when I did it.
Yeah,
and then it went to 200, and then it went down to 145. So I was like, you know what, I gotta take. Obviously, Sean Strickland can win the fight, but I can't go at plus 245.
No,
I'm minus 245 for Sean Strickland. Yeah. So I'll take that one. So I lost that one. Won the Randy Brown. Obviously won the Kevin Holland, but I didn't tape that one. I talked to you about Kevin Holland and stuff, but I forgot to tape it. That was my best pick. I said, Kevin Holland's going to win that fight. And so overall, 3-2.
Yeah, I went with the Punk's parlay. So I pulled a little Punk's parlay out, and I went with Jailton Almeida, and I went with
We've talked about it. I thought Jailton was a sure thing.
Yeah, Jailton Almeida was a sure thing. Yeah. I thought Randy Brown was a sure thing.
It wasn't. That was a tough fight,
man. That was a tough fight. A lot tougher than I thought it was going to be.
I knew Dos Santos is tough.
He is.
That guy can fight. He's a scrapper.
But anytime you're dealing with someone with that type of reach, that type of range, it's so hard to get in without getting hit. And then I went with Paulo Costa because I needed to have a dog in there somewhere to kind of sweeten the pie a little bit. You know, and that obviously ruined my parlay.
Kind of tossed that parlay right into the trash.
Yeah, I would have went with Islam if I bet it on my friends, but I don't bet on my friends. I just feel like it's an automatic curse. You start putting money on your friends.
Yeah,
just automatic. I was like, and I don't want that on my shoulders.
Yeah, the one thing that I was gonna bet on was I was gonna bet on Makhachev by submission. And I was like, you know, I don't even know what they have for the I know they have it, and I tried looking it up and I couldn't find it, and I said, I know they have this, you know, but ended up I thought I would have been wrong, but right at the end, man, that was a beautiful darce.
Wasn't looking good in the fifth there, I gotta be honest. It was looking a little dicey.
Look,
he said,
Islam was up in that fight, no matter what anyone wants to say. He won the first three rounds.
Yeah.
I thought he lost the fourth.
I can see that.
I had him losing the fourth, and then the fifth was going the way it was. And I got to say, he pulled off one of the most beautiful Russian ankle ties. Mm-hmm. Because that's like the Russian wrist tie that you whip around. He did the same maneuver on the leg, and that was how he got that. And that was beautifully done. And I think DC said, you know, these are things you don't see. And he's right. Mm-hmm. You don't see those
things. No, you don't. No.
That was absolutely a beautiful technique at a time when he was tired. And, you know, things could have gone bad for him because he was taking shots. The elbow had cut him open in the earlier round. Everything, you know, you look at and you go, and that's why you're a champion.
Absolutely. He had to dig deep in this fight.
Yes, he did.
You know, I get nervous with him in the later rounds because you don't know if the weight cut's going to have an effect. You know,
I thought he looked really good. In fact, I texted you. I said, look, Islam looks good. He looked solid. He looked filled out. His gas tank was really good overall. I mean, he was slowing down. In the fourth round is when he really slowed down. But I thought it was also he was catching some. He had to catch some air.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to have to catch it somewhere. And, you know, your output's going to go down in that round. And it's okay.
Well, most of these guys will be afraid to put the pressure on right after the exchanges in wrestling because they don't want to get taken right back down again. And Dustin was like, you know what? Screw it. I'm just going to walk you down and just throw the punches and ripping the body and just doing
great. Oh, dude, he ripped the body so well at times. There was a couple in there. I go, that hurt.
Oh, yeah.
That
hurt. Oh, yeah.
It's like, you know, when you do training for your body and tightening things up, and you have guys sit there and they rip on your body, but they're not ripping for everything, you know, they're worth. But, man, it, you know, and you're sitting there.
Yeah.
And you're trying to breathe and everything. And I was sitting there watching that. I went, yeah, that sucked. Because he was ripping it. He wasn't letting anything off on it. And I was like, yeah, those two hurt. That three hurt. Oh, that one hurt. You know, great fight, though. I really enjoyed that fight.
Look, you and I were texting back and forth. And I even brought it up on the live chat. And you said, yeah, right now, what do you rate the card? You said a six. That was before the main event.
Yes.
Now, what do you rate it?
Eight.
There you go.
Jumped it up.
And I've said this for the longest time. It doesn't matter. Look, you go back to the PFL and the Bellator cross promotion where they did the fight champs versus champs.
Yeah.
The card was one-sided. It was kind of getting a little bit boring watching Bellator guys beat up PFL guys. But yeah, I said, look, it's only going to take the main event to have a great fight and then for the PFL to steal that fight.
And explosive fight.
Explosive fight, yes. Yeah. And sure enough, nobody was talking about the rest of the card. They were just talking about that performance. That changed the way people thought. If you leave the fans on a great submission or like that, a great technique to get to the submission, that's what people are going to talk about for the rest of the night and maybe even tomorrow. Okay.
Yeah.
And that's kind of those kind of moments.
When the main event delivers.
Yes. When the main event delivers, that's what you're going to get. You're going to get buzz. You're going to get talk. And then now people can't wait to go watch another UFC. Yeah. They can't wait. They're like, hell yeah. Did you see that main event?
It's the way it's supposed to be.
Yeah, it's true. Hey, that's why they pay them the big bucks.
I mean, look, you got to be honest. That's why you have that positioning and people talked about it and saying Dustin didn't deserve it. You know, and we were going, yeah, he does. You know, and timing is part of it, you know, when you're at. But that's why you have a guy like a Dustin Poirier that comes and just brings it and goes for it and doesn't, you know, back off and doesn't just try to survive in the fight.
Yeah.
He goes after winning the fight and it made it a great fight. And he pushed Islam, pushed him as far as he could go. And, you know, and Islam was tough enough, savvy enough, pulled off one of the greatest freaking takedowns with the new Russian ankle tie. What are you going to call it? That's what it is.
When people tell me that Dustin didn't deserve it, I said, you shut your mouth when you're talking to me.
Oh, yeah.
Okay? That's what I tell
Crazy.
Them. I'm like, you guys are Crazy. Just insane. To think that his resume is the best probably in the whole sport, him and Anderson Silva. I mean, I wouldn't even – no, sorry, not Anderson. Max Holloway. Those two guys have fought everyone and anytime.
Everybody.
And
how many times?
I can't think of another fighter that has a resume like that. You know, I would put BJ Penn somewhere in there, but like it's inside the UFC, outside of the UFC. He's fought everybody. You know what I mean? I put BJ in that same little criteria there, you know?
But BJ didn't have a lot of repeats. He didn't have a lot of rematches. No. He had St. Pierre.
Matt Hughes. You know,
that was a rematch for him. Matt Hughes was a rematch for him multiple. That was three times.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he didn't have a lot of where you could take a look at Dustin, you know, fought Eddie twice, fought Connor three times, fought Max, you know. He fought Max twice.
Yeah.
Fought Max twice. You know, he's fought the, you know, Justin Gaethje twice.
But those are the good guys, man. Oh, it wasn't like God. He ran from them. It wasn't like he tried to not fight them.
Who the hell did he run from?
No one.
Exactly.
Yeah, hell no. And look, the fact that he's even bringing it up right now. You just went into the fifth round. Honestly, I had him was winning the fifth round up until that moment. It was a close fight. I know that I had Islam winning the first three rounds, but Dustin was coming on. I had him winning the fourth, like you did. And I kind of had him kind of surging in that fifth. He was landing some good shots.
Absolutely.
He was doing good. And so I'm not saying that he would have won.
And with some of the judging that was.
Yo.
Oh, my God. John,
split decision. Paul Acosta and Sean Strickland, split decision.
Oh, my God.
Jesus. I mean.
Nope.
But look.
Negative.
I don't want to hear about retirement. You want to know why I don't want to hear about retirement? I said this about a year ago. Dustin Poirier's got two more title runs in him. Okay.
There's your one.
This is one. And I think he's got one more. And the reason why I say he's got one more is because I think that Islam is going to leave to the welterweight division.
Yeah.
And when he does,
I think he is.
And when
I think he's got two more fights in lightweight.
Yeah. And I think Islam will fight Armand Sarukian. And I think he'll probably bounce out after that if he beats him. He may stick around, you know, for a Conor fight, but I don't even think Conor's going to be at 55. It'll be at 70.
It would be at 170.
Yeah. And so I look at the Armand Sarukian fight, maybe, to be honest, if Max Holloway beats Topuria, I could see Max coming up to fight Islam at 55. I could see that happening. You know,
possibility
champ versus champ. I mean, and Matt, if anyone deserves it, Max and Islam both being like, hey, you know, and Max having a great performance over Justin, it just makes sense. You know,
but you got to be careful if you're Islam. And I'm just saying it because you're in that position where everyone's now going to say, well, you fight small guys. You know, you fought Volkanovski twice, you know, and it's instead of, oh, he was the pound for pound best fighter on the planet when you fought him. You know, all of a sudden he's a small guy and you're always fighting small guys and now you're fighting another featherweight chance. Like, you got to be careful of it because those kind of things, people don't give you the credit for those wins when you get them when they're not easy.
Well, Max Holloway, when he fought Justin, I think he weighed over 180.
Max Holloway
weighed
178 pounds.
Oh, okay.
The night of the fight with Jose Aldo. When he won the interim title and he took the 145 pound title from Aldo. And that night he stepped on the scale. They put him on the scale. He was 178 pounds. I go, how in the hell did you get?
No idea.
But he did.
John, like Volkanovski and Islam both weighed 178 when they fought their first fight.
Yeah.
And Max going from 145 to 178.
That's
insane.
Yeah,
that's insane. Look, I don't want to hear Dustin retiring. I want to keep him I want to keep him there. I think he's got another title run. I understand why, though. I get it.
Okay, and this is the point. Anytime you start to talk about retirement, Josh, it's probably time to retire.
Yeah.
Because it's saying that you got a foot outside the door, and once you got one foot outside the door, I'm not. I truly believe, you know, that he can fight with anybody. In the lightweight division, he can give anybody, you know, a fight that you can, you know, it's a 50-50 on who's going to win or you're going to pick Dustin. And he's that good. And he's got these things about him. You take a look at, you know, the matchup with Islam. Yeah, on the feet, Islam looked good. Mm-hmm. He really did. But I still say Dustin was a little bit better on the feet. I thought he landed overall the harder shots when they were thrown, you know, There was a couple things that happened in the fight, you know, a couple head clashes that happened and things like that that I had a little bit of effect. But on the feet, Islam looked great. Mm. The calf kick really didn't become part of the equation until too late in the fight. Dustin really didn't get to that, and I understand why. He was worried about getting taken down. But where you could see the big difference, and Dustin's good on the ground. Mm-hmm. He's good. And he survived some of those situations. But, you know, that's what happens when, you know, you're surviving, but time's going out and you're losing. You know, and you could see the level of what Islam brings on the ground is a real problem for everybody. It's a problem for everybody.
It's a rinse, wash, repeat. And I wish I was trying to explain that to people on the live show. Was that, look, he will get to half guard. He'll take you down and get to half guard. When he gets to half guard, he attacks the same submissions. And the same way you defend it is by giving your back. And he goes right to your back. He does it every single time. And it works. It's no different. Look, we're not reinventing the wheel. You know, look at Jake Shields. Same techniques every single time. And it freaking works. When you know the answer to the problem that you're creating, it's easy to get to the solution.
Yeah.
And that's what exactly it is. I can't believe I just got that out of my mouth in the right way. Because it was, it's exactly what he works on and understanding where that person can go. Look, jiu-jitsu is about forcing your opponent to go where you want them to so you can exploit them.
You're moving, you're getting that move where you already know where you want the person to go.
Exactly. And so, and he does it very well. And I see it coming. I was watching it tonight, talking through it. And until you understand the pressure in which they're putting on you, and you realize, you're like, why did he go that way?
The difference is, no, people can't. You can sit there and say, oh my God, there's so much pressure. If you don't feel it, you'll never know.
And it's the pressure that makes you go that way. That's the thing. It's like, I'm putting that pressure so you will turn your chin this way and you will start to give me your back and you will, you know, you won't turn.
But you have to.
Yeah, you have to.
You have to.
So, and Dustin did a great job defending the back a couple of times. I thought Islam made a mistake in the third round by giving up the back position. He went to the top position instead. He had kind of like a rear naked, but his other hand was facing out and he just was trying to do it with one hand. I mean, anytime you're on the back, he could have won that round for sure, 100%, and just kept the back.
Excuse me.
It's 2:30 in the morning, you guys. We're filming this for you guys. For you guys. but yeah, it really came down to, I felt like he could have potentially lost that round had he not, when he did give up the back. And I was like, you should have just stayed on the back. I look at the back as is like kind of the holy grails of positions. Because you're not really taking
any, be hurt.
Yeah, you can't really take any damage there. Mm-hmm. And you have all these submissions at your fingertips. You have the rear naked. You've got, you know, you can even tuck the arm behind the back. You know, I can start trying to hit arm bars from that position. And I can just sit back there and chill while I have the figure four.
All while I always have the opportunity to rattle your skull.
Yeah. This is true.
That's the thing it's everything.
Do you think he's going to start getting the credit he deserves now a little bit more? Islam?
No. I don't. I really don't. And the reason why is it's where he comes from and who he is part of. I think people will always look and say, oh, yeah, he's good, but he's not Habib. They're just always going to do it. It's just part of and the fact that Habib is still there and then they're ending up fighting the same people. And it ends up where Habib got rid of Dustin in the third round, right? Took Islam into the fifth round. Okay. But that's the kind of comparisons that people like to make. Mm. And you and I both know MMA math. You can't look at it that way. But when you look at the situations that you saw Dustin get out of tonight, he did not get out of those situations against Habib. Now that is possibly because he learned, you know, and he learned from the fight with Habib. Hey, I got to figure out how do I get out of this? And so then he had an answer going up against Islam. But I always say if Islam ends up fighting Connor, I don't think Connor is the same fighter he was when he fought Habib. But if Islam doesn't get rid of him faster, then again, people are going to say, see, Habib got rid of him, you know, made him tap out in this round. And it's just one of those, since they're in the same weight class and Habib is still there in his corner, I think people are always going to look at him. He's the top dog.
Let me just clarify. Let me point this out, though. I could play devil's advocate and say, yeah, do you guys recall the Gleason-Tibau fight?
Yeah. Gleason-Tibau got knocked out.
Quickly.
By
Islam.
By Islam.
Quickly.
And gave Habib a 3-round fight.
Gave him fits. I remember people talking. I remember seeing.
I remember people thinking he won.
Yeah. They were like, oh, he won that fight. You know, he got gifted that decision. Yeah, that's what they were saying. Fight, but, yeah. I was like, I don't know what fight you guys are watching.
But yeah, you're absolutely right. But people, when you go back that far and he wasn't champion, yeah, it's like, you know, it is what it is. I think Islam has 2 fights left as a lightweight, and I think he will go up to welterweight. Mm-hmm. And I think there's good matchups for him there, and I think there's some tough matchups for him there. I think if he does decide to go to 170, there are some things that he's going to want to tighten up on. Mm-hmm. For the people that are in that division. And that's just, you know, but that's part of the sport. You have to evolve. You continuously must evolve in this sport if you want to be relevant.
Give me like in that welterweight division for Islam. Give me somebody. Like, I know Leon. Look, to me, Leon's going to be probably his toughest.
Leon's
fight.
A problem for him.
Yes.
I know, you know, people. And the reason why I say it's the same reason that Leon's going to be a problem for Bilal, because Bilal and Islam are very similar. I think Islam's got better stand up than Bilal. Their wrestling is different, but yeah. But where Bilal's going to have problems with Leon is the same place that Islam is. And Islam is he's a good athlete, but he's not super fast. Mm-hmm. He's got decent speed. But he's not real fast. Leon is real fast. Mm-hmm. Leon has got fast hands. His ability to move his body in and out and create a change of distance creates a problem for you when you're not used to it. So Islam has to either do one of 2 things. He's going to have to make up his mind. I'm just going to crush space and take the chance of being hit. That's not always a good idea. It's, you know, that's why you're shaking your head.
No, I know.
So, you know, but it is one of those things when you're facing someone that is going to be that much faster than you, that is, well, it can get me into them and get me through that problem of them being on the outside, because I either want to be all the way out if I'm Islam against Leon, or I want to be all the way in. I don't want to be in that mid-range. Mm-hmm. The mid-range is a bad spot for me. So, you know, I look and say that Leon it presents a lot of problems because he's a sharpshooter. He's a sniper with his stand-up. He's very, very slick in how he'll set certain things up. And he's accurate. When he wants to hit a spot, he hits it pretty well. Mm-hmm. He makes you move towards his power. That's what a good fighter does. He's also, you know, he fights southpaw most of the fight. You know, Islam seems to have a little bit more problem when it comes to southpaws, which, you know, because he's a southpaw himself, people, well, why would he have problems with it? Because he doesn't train against a ton of southpaws. He trains against a bunch of people that fight orthodox. And so it's something that he's going to have to continue to work on in fighting and finding that positioning and that range that's comfortable for him. So, you know, Leon's the bigger athlete. He's longer. The speed is a problem. And he's very difficult to take down now. I'm not saying that Islam can't take him down, but he defends in a different way than most people. And Islam is going to really have to figure out, okay, how do I get past him taking one of my arms away?
Yeah.
Because that's what he does.
He's the best, I think, right now in getting back up to his feet in the game.
Really good.
Yeah, Leon Edwards right now is the best. He got double wrist control, keeping the way he scrapes you off the back. He's just turning and facing. And I know it seems so just basically like elementary style, like wrestling. But those are the fundamentals of wrestling.
But think about this, Josh, and it is, you're exactly right. Yeah. Because, you know, one of the things you're taught early on in wrestling is a 2-on-1.
Yeah.
Right? 2-on-1. And it's an offensive maneuver. I put 2-on-1 and I start to change the angle of your body. And now I can get into my takedown, right? Leon had just turned that around and he made the 2-on-1 a defensive technique to keep him from being able mm-hmm. to be taken down. And it's really working.
Yeah, because you go, I remember going back when he fought Gunnar Nelson. Everyone's like, oh, he's going to get mollywopped by Gunnar Nelson. Do we recall how that grappling match went? It went, it was nasty.
Did not go Gunnar's way.
Yeah. And so, and then you look at, I look at Islam as he's a phenomenal wrestler, but I think he's going to end up with problems like he did a little bit tonight, especially in the third and fourth and fifth round. When you get sweaty, those body lock takedowns are very difficult to get. Guys start slipping in, get the double unders. They're able to start going over under. Like, they're able to start making space and getting their body away.
It's also, when you take a look at it, and it's as simple as it gets, digging for your underhook. When people are dry and the guy goes, and you've got that body lock, and it goes, they go to get that, and you just squeeze in a little bit, and they're not sliding shit. But third round, they go, whoop,
yeah,
and they just rip it through, and it's like, son of a bitch.
Yeah,
it's the difference.
And as you do it, because you are sweaty, the hands are locked behind the back. They're normally locked probably like low back. You're trying to get it low back. As soon as you put that hand in and you drop your hips, those hands slide up to your shoulders. Then there goes the lock.
They definitely slide up to mid back,
yeah,
which is exactly where you don't want them. Mm. You either want to be down low on the hips or up high, having their arms where, you know, you got them up and you're riding their arms up high. So yeah, you're absolutely right.
Give me your overall wrap on this fight. Give me like your overall analyst, of this fight.
I'm being honest, to analyze the fight itself, I thought that Islam had a very good game plan. He executed their game plan very well. Right away, come on, think about how fast he actually went into that takedown, mm-hmm. you know, at the start. Smart, because why am I going to fight Dustin where he's strongest? Where I have the greatest advantage is towards the ground. He spent most of that first round just grinding on Dustin. And basically, in a way, he's telling him, this is the way it's going to be. Mm-hmm. And you got to give it up for Dustin to have the mental capacity to go, all right, no problem. You know, because he did. You know, he knew he lost the round. And yeah. He knew that it, you know, sucked. And, you know, right away, Mike Brown, you know, came and said, hey, he can't take you down in the open, but he can take you down against the cage. You got to keep yourself off of the cage. You know, you got to look at the cage. The cage is fire. You know, don't get burned. Yeah. And so I thought they both had the right game plans for their specific skill sets. Dustin's was to stay on in the middle of the cage and to move and, you know, just, you know, pick him apart with sniper shots. You know, I can't throw big time combinations.
No.
Because if I throw big combinations, it's going to put me out of position and he's going to end up getting into me. And then I'm going to end up in a bad position on the ground. So I thought both of them had the right game plans for their opponents. I thought that the momentum of the fight really started off with Islam and maintained a little bit. Dustin had his moments. But after the third round, I thought the momentum really started to shift towards Dustin. Mm-hmm. And it was an interesting, you know, way of looking at it based upon he had lost all three rounds, the first three, and all of a sudden that momentum is now in his court. How it's in his court when Islam has won every round? It was just the way that the fight was playing out, which I thought was super interesting. I thought it was a great game plan by both coaching staffs. I thought the fighters executed exactly the way they were supposed to. And I really give Islam just ungodly credit, first for the takedown, the way he did it. Daniel was right. It's never been done like that. The closest thing that you would see towards that would have been Randy Couture against James Toney, yeah, with the ankle pick, yeah, rubbing the shoulder into the knee, right? It's like, okay, but... And then him with that fight the way it was, going after that finish
and getting dust in the tap right as he was going out. And he did go out. You can see it.
Yeah, yeah. He put his head down on the canvas after that.
Yeah. Yeah, he dried it. Yeah.
My overall analysis of the fight was they both fought their asses off. I think Islam had a very good game plan. My concern always with his game plan is as the fight goes on, that those body lock takedowns are just, they're not existing anymore. They're very difficult to get to. Guys sure. have a good job. They do a really good job of pummeling in, do a good job of, you know, you're sweaty. It's Staying hard to grip and hold. Fence. Yeah. They're able to kind of circle out to the overhook side, you know, dip the head and come out on the overhook side. I also don't like this. I'm going to critique Islam a little bit. I don't like the tie clinch thing. I don't know what he's doing, but the tie clinch thing, anytime you get in close enough like that, he goes to the tie clinch. Now, I understand there's moments to do it to throw the knee up the middle, which he busted yeah. Dustin's nose up with a good shot.
Yes, he did. That's what I was going to bring up. Yep. Like, well, he was kind of effective with it, so.
It was, but go like, ahead. As you get sweatier, though, those become very difficult to keep track of. The gloves get blood on them. They get sweat on them. You try to put the hand over the top, then it starts slipping off. The hair and everything is sweaty. It just... Though it's very easy, it's a lot easier to get out of those positions. Now, sure. I know it wears on you and makes you tired. But also, too, I've seen a lot of fighters get knocked out in the gym by keeping the chin in the air by getting the clinch work. So they hug the head on the clinch and their chin is up because they're trying to bring their head down. So they're trying to raise their body up to bring the head down. They can't. The guy comes over the top with an overhand right or left and boom. Homeboy's sleeping. And so I got a little concerned in those exchanges. Islam had to dig deep tonight. I think it was a good show of character for him. I can sit here and tell you guys all day long how great he is on the ground. We all know how good he is, but I've always said this and I've said it forever. His stand-up is drastically underrated.
Yeah.
Very underrated.
Now, absolutely.
I think not only is his stand-up underrated, but what it is that people have to respect his wrestling so much. And you could see it all night tonight, especially in the first three, almost four rounds. Dustin would throw and then he'd stop in the middle of his throw because he was waiting for the takedown attempts. So he would throw the one and the two, and then it was like he would pause for a second to see if he should throw the three. And then that's when Islam was able to counter, or he was able to at least feint something that made him react and then made Dustin circle out. And then he never really got off enough that would land enough to really do any damage to Islam or to really make him concerned about much. I thought Dustin, a great game plan. I got to be honest. I didn't think the wrestling was going to be as important as it was. I thought Islam was going to be able to take him down at will. I thought that Dustin would be able to get up, you know, a couple times. But I thought that this would probably go into the third, maybe the fourth submission-wise, and he'd catch him. Dustin hit a switch, I think, in the fifth round.
Oh, fourth round.
Fourth round. I was like, what the hell did I just see?
Beautiful.
Beautifully done. And
oh, wait. It was just gorgeous.
You have to see is it was timed perfectly. Islam was behind him on the side, and Dustin was waiting to sit out. Islam circled to the right side, and boom, he caught the leg as he started circling and used his momentum against him and then sat out and switched. Just the timing, the execution, all of that was beautifully done. I don't want to see him walk away because I know that he still has more in him. And I know, and I'm going to keep going back to this. I got a lot of respect for the guy. I got nothing but love for Dustin Poirier, man. Everything about him is, if I was to pick somebody that I'm like, hey, and not just him, but there's other guys too. Charles Oliveira being one of them as well. You know, just guys that you would like to have your kids look up to and be like, hey, that's a fighter I like watching. Those are the kind of guys, you know, and they're class acts wherever they go. You know, the whole mother effort thing at the weigh-ins or whatever at the press conference. But look, he came in and he apologized and there was an understanding like, hey, like we're not talking about people's families here. And I know like in Americans and George and I were talking about this on the live thing. We think of that. And we're like, yeah, whatever. No big deal now because we've heard it so long.
Yeah.
But in other countries and other cultures, let's not just say in Dagestan, let's just say other cultures. Like what? You said something about like you brought my mom into this, really? Like that's where we're going with this? Like we're talking about mothers now? Like we've gotten so detached from what words, you know, mean. Which I'm cool. Sticking stones may break my bones. Words may never hurt me. About stuff. Go right ahead with all that.
Yeah.
You know, but look, a lot of cultures don't feel that way. You know, and so I like that Dustin went in and they talked about it, and you know, and they understand. And I thought that was a very, it was a very class act move by him. And got nothing but respect for the guy, man. I don't want to see him walk away. Like I said, I think he's got one more good title run in him. I'd like to see him do it. Overall, good fight, though.
But let me ask you this. When you say you don't want to see him walk away, mm-hmm. you were okay with Habib walking away.
Was I, though?
Yeah.
I was only based on the fact that, like...
Based upon his father and everything.
Yeah, it wasn't even so much... It was more based on what he told his mother. And when you only have one parent, you cherish that one parent a lot. I mean, I've only got one parent. My mom and I were never close, and mm-hmm. I cherish her a lot more now. And we never really got along, but I've tried to put her, you know, on a level where I can communicate with her, you know, and look, him, he obviously has a different relationship with his mother and, you know, and his father meant the world to him. But let's be honest, man, like mama doesn't want to see him do that. And he doesn't want to do it. You got to respect a man for that. You know, a lot of guys would have taken the money. A lot of guys would have taken the money. In terms of Dustin, I mean, look, you making promises to your daughter and your wife, I understand. You don't need to explain to anybody, especially me. But I simply am like thinking to myself, we had Mike Brown on, and Mike Brown's like, yeah, man, he's definitely made a ton of money. I can understand. Look, I've made decent amount of money. I've done well with myself in terms of taking care of my money. But look, the economy does this.
Sure does.
Taxes do this, and
no, taxes don't do this.
Taxes do this. Yeah, they do. They do an incline. Yeah, but simply saying, like, you don't know where you're going to be, and this is your biggest chance and opportunity to make the most amount of money you can. Now, I'm not saying I want to see you go out there and take a ton of damage. I don't want that for anybody. But when you know you can cash in for another, you know, $1 million, $2 million, whatever it is. It doesn't matter how good you are with your money. Look, we've seen guys in the NFL, and I know like they're younger, they're all these things. Millionaires and billionaires can go broke. Doesn't matter. It happens all the time on a daily basis. So to think that because you know you made $10 million or $15 million in your career, it doesn't mean that you can't go broke. Anything can happen. The housing market can crash. You can, you know, whatever it is. You know, you have money in stock, it can crash. It can happen. So I think that those opportunities that you have to make this amount of money and me being 46 years old coming up, these are the times where like, hey, don't think that those opportunities, like, look, I went into doing comics, John, they're not going to be there forever. You have this short period of time, make as much as you can. Now you start taking too much damage and this and that, then I get it. But this is those moments, man, because you're going to go, I think almost everyone's going to look back in about 2 years and go, kind of made me feel like I could have done it for some more. That ship sailed now. John, you and I have talked about it. I miss fighting, but I don't miss fighting. Like I go run a little bit and I'm like, okay, I'm done with missing it. You know, like that's kind of the reality. But like the thing is, you're never going to be as in good a shape. If you take a year off, you're not going to be as good a shape as you were when you left. Your timing, all that stuff, you got to build that back up. And at 35, you can't afford to take a year off.
And people talk about it. It's like, well, you know, you can go and do something. Like, go do triathlons. You will not be in as good a shape for fighting. The triathlon will not get you there. I'm not saying you're not in good shape, but you're not in fight shape.
Ask Paul Felder.
Difference. Yeah, there you go.
You know, and because
Paul Felder, he came back and fought Dos Anjos after he was doing.
He was in good shape. But guess what? If you're going to spend that amount of time doing triathlons, you're not spending that amount of time in the gym doing the techniques to get you up off the ground. And that's what Paul Felder found out. Look, he was phenomenally in great shape. Wasn't breathing heavy. Wasn't all those things. But guess what? His takedown defense sucked. Yeah. And that's the reality is, it's like, if you're going to do triathlons, you have to give up the other stuff to do this. So you've got to learn, like, this fighters, they've learned to, okay, today is wrestling day, tomorrow sparring day. Okay. Next day is mitts. You know, the following day is jujitsu. Like you schedule it so you get a little bit of everything all week. And once you step away for a year and try to come back in a year and a half, it's not, the timing's off, the grappling's off, the strength, all that stuff is off. Yeah, because the daily grind of lifting somebody else's body off of you, does tendon strength, muscle strength, all that stuff is gone now. It's not gone. It's just not what it was when you were doing this and now you're kind of just doing this and you're trying to build it back up, but it looks like a little tiny bump in the road kind of thing and gaining. So I would like to see him make as much money as he possibly can. And he's been in some dog fights.
Oh my God.
You know, but I look at Armand's next. I look at Dustin. I'm like, he beats Armand.
Okay.
He beats Armand. Armand's not going to submit him, and he may get submitted by Armand. I mean, Armand might submit him, you know, and yeah. in terms of relaxation in a 5-round fight, I'm going with Dustin. I'm going with Dustin. The amount of wrestling, if he continues to get, like, he fights Armand. Let's say he fought Armand next, not next, Islam's going to fight him next, but if he fought him next after that, and he just continued to work with Gamrot and his wrestling, I mean, he's going to be a lot better. And then his relaxation on the feet, understanding, like, you can't take me down. I don't know, man. I think he beats him. I'd like to see Dustin and Charles run it back. I'd like to see that fight. That's a fun fight.
That'd be a good fight.
Anyways, overall, great main event tonight. You know, Islam walks away as the hashtag and still, just like this podcast, hashtag and still. And, you know, John, let's go into the co-main event. The co-main event left us desiring a little bit more.
It honestly left a ton to be desired. And it was, oh my God, it was the last 15 seconds of the fight. Nah. That was the fight.
The Fabricio Werdum kicks across the cage were amazing.
But that was the fight that you wanted to see.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I thought that Sean, first off, the fact that a judge went 49-46 for Paulo Costa. I'm sorry, but I don't know what you were looking at. Sean Strickland in that fight, it was an easy fight to score. It was not hard. Everything at near the end of the rounds, in first, second, and third, gave you, Sean is putting shots on him, knocking him down, knocking him off balance, all these things. You know, once again, And I thought he threw more than he has in the past. Paulo just is not throwing. He doesn't put out enough volume. And I think it's exactly what you've talked about. He's afraid of getting tired. And so he holds back, you know, knowing, oh, I can't burn a lot of gas. I can't burn a lot of gas. You know, I'll put certain shots out there. I thought that the front push kick by Sean throughout the fight.
Yeah.
First off, it hurts. Everyone that thinks, oh, it's no big deal. It not only hurts your goddamn body, it hurts your arms trying to block it, okay? Sweeping it away all the time, your forearms start to get beat up, swelling, all these things that happen.
Tony Ferguson.
People don't think about it. You know, just be honest. I've been kicked so many times in the arms putting my arm in to stop something. And every freaking time it feels like, okay, I can't feel my arm.
Yeah.
It's dead. Yeah. Okay.
Tony Ferguson, people, man. When I fought him, I had a bump on my forearm for fucking almost a week and a half. It wouldn't go down.
Yeah.
It was fucking horrible.
And it's like, you know, it's seriously, you'll go to grip after that. And it's like, I can't really tell how hard I'm gripping. It's a weird feeling. And this is what happens to your arms. And then you're supposed to be throwing shots. You know, this is just that simple technique does wonders for Sean in allowing him to come forward like you want, put pressure, but it actually beats up his opponent a lot more than people think, you know, and it slows down their progression by making their arms a little heavier and all those things. So I thought that, you know, the fight went kind of how I thought it was going to. I thought that, you know, we talked about it, you know, Sean's going to, you know, just walk forward and eventually he's going to start wearing down. I'll give it to him. He was able to maintain himself. And I thought in the fifth round, he was fighting really well. That was Sean won the first three rounds. I thought Paulo did better in the fourth. He still didn't win it. You know, just because he does better doesn't mean he wins the round. You got to go off of the shots that are thrown, the ones that are landed. And are they landed to a legal area? You know, the ones that are bouncing off of Sean's shoulders, that's not a landed blow. That's a block. That's good defense. It doesn't go down as anything, you know, and you look and you go, fifth round, I actually had Paulo doing well for a while. The output was more, and that's what you needed to see from the start of the fight. And then, you know, Sean went on his 15 second, you know, Fabricio were doomed jumping for kick, but you know, he put him down, you know, and he went after him, and he basically won the round just based upon knocking him down. You know, so
how did
simple fight.
So look, I thought the first round was first or the second round, I can't remember, but both of them ended with like an off balance kind of like punch slash knockdown.
Yeah.
But I mean, I had Paulo Costa. He landed the harder leg kicks in the first and the second round. He landed some good shots. I know some of them.
He landed good leg kicks in the first round.
In the first round. And then he came out, I think, in the third, and he had like four or five in a row that Sean didn't check either.
Boy, he had the one that was checked that hurt him. And
oh, I saw that.
Oh, it hurt him.
Yeah, bad. Yeah. He was hobbling around for a good probably 20 seconds.
Oh, yeah. He was like, oh, my God, that hurt.
Yeah, bro. I've had a couple of those. Those are the worst, man. But not with the knees. He checked with the knee. I've kicked to the elbow. Oh, just the worst. It basically sends that sharp pinpoint, and then sharp pain goes all the way up into your shin, like you're into your... Oh,
it goes into up into your hip.
Oh, yeah. It hurts. It hurts. You know... Yeah, I was kind of just like, man, I felt like Paulo could have won one of the first two rounds. I didn't really give a whole lot of credence to the knockdown off balance kind of throwing the kick. You know, he landed the shot, but it wasn't a hard shot. One of them was with a jab. No. He just stepped in and knocked him over. But mm-hmm. I felt Paulo landed enough punches in the, I think maybe in the second round, one of the rounds that I gave it to Paulo. But outside of that, I had Sean running away with it. It was, you know, Sean, I just couldn't stop talking about Sean, watching him do what he was doing.
Because he was so relaxed. He was in total control of the fight.
So relaxed.
He looked like he was sparring.
Yeah. Which is what he does, John.
I know, but you know, but he looked like he was just, you know, another day of sparring at Extreme Couture, while Paulo looked like he was stressing, you know, trying to figure out, how do I get to this guy? How do I land the shots? And he just, overall, he didn't land many shots.
Yeah, I mean, like,
he really didn't.
He
went to the body a couple times really well, but headshots, he didn't land a lot.
Let's be honest. He, like, in reality, like, I'm looking back going, like, okay, look, both of us took Paulo Costa because of the betting odds being what they were. Yeah. Like, oh, he's a plus 210 or 205, I think is what
because
I had.
Because he's got the ability and power to put someone away.
But okay. John, I don't know, in my mind, as I'm watching back the fight in my mind, I'm going, how did I ever even think that was a safe bet? No, like what Sean Strickland did to Izzy, who is a better striker than Paulo Costa.
Yes.
And, but then I think what happened was the DDP fight lingered in my mind that Sean didn't fight his fight. He got tired. Yeah. He went like fighting like Izzy to fighting this way. And I'm like, well, that should have been a reality check. Because then he went back to fighting the way he fought Izzy, where he just walked forward, push kicked up the middle, jab, 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 push kick, land a hard right, now just chase you with big loopy shots and knock you down. You know, it's like, it's kind of textbook for him. And that's the way you should fight every time. He doesn't fight well going backwards. He's not a backwards fighter. Him going forward is the hammer. He's so relaxed. He just makes
Taylor
you miss.
Taylor made to do it. Yes.
Yeah, right outside of range. Makes you miss, makes you pay. Then he puts a little push kick in the gut. John, those things suck, man. They suck.
They do.
You know? And so he's got it down. And then on top of that, trying to kick his calf, you got to catch him right at the right time because he's constantly lifting it up like Charles Oliveira. And it's just avoiding the kick. It's constantly avoiding the kick. And he fought a very good fight. I couldn't stop talking about Sean's performance. Just so relaxed, so composed, slipping in out of range. Just touching him with the jab, snapping, boom, right hand. Now let me beat you up some more, and let me back out before you swing back.
If I'm going to say anything about Sean and something that he's not doing enough, he doesn't use his right hand enough.
This is true.
He needs to use it more.
Look, the most underutilized thing in the game right now is the jab. Right now, of course. I mean, pretty much since the conception of the sport. But
75% of his offense.
Yeah.
Yeah. Is the jab.
Yeah. He's money, man. He's got it down. If he just continues to fight that way, I don't think DDP beats him again. If they fight again, if Sean fights that way, I don't think DDP beats him.
I think if they're going to fight again, Sean needs to get in touch with his good friend Johnny Eblen and have Johnny out there trying to take him down continuously, putting good shots on him in the stand-up and then going after the takedowns. And get yourself to where, okay, I am going to move forward.
Yeah.
and put DDP on his back foot and don't take any backward steps because you're worried about the takedowns and stuff. And let the fight just unfold because that's how you do it. You do the best.
True. Next fight.
Ah, we had Kevin Holland going up against Michael Olchek. Olchek just, you know, dude, he's got power. He put a good shot on Kevin. Yeah, you know, a lot of people was, oh, he's really hurt. You could see by the way he fell and by his eyes, he wasn't that hurt, but he got put down. But, you know, it was just a matter of, you know, smart. You know, Højgaard goes after the arm. You know, a lot of people, I hear people saying, well, you know, he didn't tap. No, he didn't. But it's called a technical submission. And the reason it's called a technical submission, his arm dislocated.
Mm.
Okay.
Told you, George.
As soon as his arm dislocated, and it dislocated 5 seconds at least before Herb stopped it. Mm-hmm. But from that moment, the fight is over.
Yeah.
It's over. As soon as the arm dislocates. Now, yes, I can pull out a ton of fights where the arm dislocates and the referee stands there like a moron and doesn't stop the fight. But in the back, it should be that the referee tells the fighter, and this is when, you know, I would tell you, hey, if you get caught in a submission, I will let you work your way out of any submission there is. What I need you to know is that as long as you are fighting your way out of it, I'm going to let you go. If I see damage, if I see it dislocate or I see it break, I'm telling you right now, the fight is over. You lose. Okay? You cannot move on. If it's your finger, your toe, no problem. If your arm dislocates, your shoulder pops out, the fight is over. And that's exactly what happened.
So weird. I remember Rich Conkleton when he fought Hermes Franca. They didn't stop that shit.
Again. Yeah, guess why?
Why?
Because you had a referee that had no idea what he was
looking at. Who was it? Steve Mazzagatti?
Oh, no, no.
Who was that?
His last name is Warren.
Wow. Okay.
And James Warren. James Waring.
That was nasty. That shit's
well. James Waring played professional football with the Raiders. He was a professional kickboxer, and he had no idea at all about submission. And you look at it, I was screaming from the thing. Stop the fight! Stop the fight! Nope. And Hermes Franca is stopping, pointing at the elbow, going, "Hey, hey, hey! Look, nope.
Yeah." And then Rich, right after it goes back, like kind of like whips back into place a little bit, he punches with it. Kind of
popped in, yeah.
And then he punches with it. I was like, you son of a
Crunkleton was a little crazy.
Yeah, himself, you think? you know, I thought Kevin fought a good fight, man. Kevin looked confident out there. He fought a good fight outside of the first round, getting put to his butt a little bit. I thought he fought a great fight.
You know, I loved what he said, even though I don't think he's a gatekeeper. But he's in that position that they use him to fight anybody.
Yeah.
To come in last minute to fill in, and they know, hey, it's kind of like there was this old freaking commercial on TV when I was a kid about Life cereal, and it was like, you know, hey, give it to Mikey, he'll try it. Mikey will eat anything.
Yeah.
Hey, Mikey likes it. Well, Kevin Holland is Mikey because he likes fighting. Give it to Kevin. Kevin will like the fight. Yeah, look at Kevin. Right, He's a good person. He's a good fighter. And man, he's fun. I really enjoy every time he goes out there because I know I'm going to see a good fight. I know he's going to fight hard. Sometimes he doesn't fight smart. I'm just going to put it out there. There's times when I go, what are you doing? You know, like when he fought, Stephen Thompson. Yeah. But hey, he really can. He can hang and he's tough and, you know, he can be beat, but man, he can beat most people too. So.
Yeah, he's got all the attributes to be a top, like I would say a top five guy, you know, especially at 170. Well,
I'll tell you what, I'm going to be honest about this. The one attribute he doesn't have, he's not mean.
Yeah,
he's not.
That's true.
Because I'm telling you right now, Frank Mir had that arm. Look, just watching that fight. You know, he sat there and he's kind of like, you know, trying to put a little more pressure, like it is training. And, you know, kind of looks up and, you know, hey, you know, and finally says, okay, I'm going to have to do this. I'm sorry. You know, and puts it, you know, under his arm. And I mean, all I'm telling you is, you know, Frank Mir, dude, as soon as he grabbed that arm, he's trying to take it off of your body. Carlos Condit, he's trying to take it off your body. Josh Barnett, he's trying to take it off of your body. He wants to take that thing, pull it off your body, and smack you in the head with it to say, here, this is what you should have realized when I grabbed it.
We've had lunch with Frank, and he's talked about how in fights, put it on, and like he's like, oh, you're going to keep trying to fight out of it. Fine.
Oh, no problem.
Just take it with me. overall, good performance. Jailton Almeida versus Alexander Romanov.
What are you talking about? How did you go all the way down to that one?
That was the next fight.
It wasn't.
Yeah.
No, you had Nico Price and
That's not on my. I'm sorry, Alex Morano. I know, but I don't have that on. Sorry, it's not on my UFC scheduled fights.
Oh, I'm sorry.
There you go. I'll skip to that then, because I have. I've got this Almeida. Randy Brown.
Alex Morano going up against Nico Price was the fight, but this was one of those ones. I didn't realize that Alex took it so with only a couple weeks.
And are you trying to justify your bad betting?
Yeah. But let's be honest. This is one of those fights you can take a look at. And I like Nico Price. He is a very tough-minded individual, good person. He does not have the skill set that Alex Morano has. Doesn't. Not in the stand-up. Not on the ground. He's not as fast. He's tough as hell, and that's why he won that fight. Toughness and conditioning won him the fight. Mm. Okay? And he deserved it. But Alex Morano, most of the time, doesn't get tired. This one, Josh, he was dying.
Yeah.
You could see it. I mean, he was labored. Somewhere in that second round, it hit. And it was not good from that point. And that was the difference in the fight.
Yeah, it's the fatigue thing, man. You cannot afford to be, to be tired out there for a split second. Because what happens is, like, it's not even so much like you trying to take a step back. As soon as, no matter how tired your opponent is, when they see that you're tired, they automatically step forward.
Feel better.
Yeah. It makes them feel like they've got that card. Let's be honest. How many times have you seen two guys barely be able to stand up in the third round, and then that 10-second bell goes, and all of a sudden they've got a burst of energy? You know what I mean? Like or guys so exhausted, the guy can barely keep his arms up. Then he throws a wild punch and lands it, and then he gets a burst of energy trying to finish the guy, and sometimes gets it, sometimes doesn't. But you know what I mean? Like, all of a sudden, there's that energy that deep down in there is just like stored away, you know. Yeah. But this was not the case. This was one of those things you're just running on fumes the whole time. Pure exhaustion. She's so tired. So, yeah. But I thought Morano fought a good fight for taking the fight on short notice, and then also too being a dog. Look, Price is hard. He's difficult to deal with. I mean, it's just one of those fights that you got to continue to stay in the fight. And if you don't have the cardio to go the distance, it can be a tough night.
Yes, if you don't have the power to make Nico truly respect that power, he'll give you problems because he'll keep on marching forward.
Yeah.
Randy Brown taking on Dos Santos. This was a good fight. This was one of the ones that I thought was actually really good. It was a good scrap back and forth. Randy Brown, you know, getting the win, but he was in trouble in a couple of instances in that fight. Dos Santos had his moments where he was looking pretty good. Randy ended up turning around that one round, you know. It was like the way he was defending. I'm like, that's not a good way to defend, but okay, whatever you're going to do. But, you know, and he got himself out and turns it around and puts it on Dos Santos. But really a good back and forth battle. It was one of the better fights of the night.
Definitely one of the best fights of the night. Randy Brown made it a little bit more difficult than he should have, but Dos Santos is a tough fighter. Look, anytime you have someone of that length, that height, and that reach, and the ability to use their footwork to keep out of range. And then also, too, look, it's extremely
difficult. That knee up the middle.
But yeah. Ugh. That was nasty. That was nasty. But, John, it's even when you get them down, guys of that length and their reach, they can push on the head, and then now you're, like, down by their ankles trying to work your way up the body. It's so difficult. Not everyone has the Islam Makhachev, you know, Russian ankle pick thing going on, you know? And so I don't think Randy Brown has that in his toolbox. He may discover it now, but after the fact, he fought a good fight. I obviously thought he won, but it was one of those fights where he made it. I felt like he made it a little bit more difficult than he needed to.
Yeah.
He could have potentially had an easier fight. He didn't use the range enough. Didn't use the low level calf kicks. Use that push kick up the face a little bit more. That type of reach, man, that would be like one of my bread and butters, to the butt, to the bread basket and to the face. And just mix it up. And then every once in a while, yeah, throw a question mark kick in there because they think you're going to come up the middle, and then boom, yep, you're right there over the question
right
mark
over
kick.
The top. Yeah,
they're dropping the elbows. And with that type of length, man, you can do the world is your fucking, what, the world's your oyster kind of bullshit. You know, it's, you have so many weapons in there just because of your physical body. You know, jeez. All right, next fight.
Roman Kopylov taking on Cesar Almeida. Almeida coming in with an undefeated record. Here's a guy that actually
Wait, did you skip over Jelinton Almeida?
No, that's the one after.
Jesus, man. My thing's all messed up here then.
I'm giving you an order.
Okay,
here.
I'll stick with you. I'm going to turn my shit off.
You are just a mess.
Go ahead. It is 3 a.m, John.
This is true.
I gotta take my son to soccer in the morning.
All right.
It's about an hour away at 8 a.m. So I gotta leave the house at 7.
7?
Yeah. All right, sorry, go ahead. Sorry. Roman Kopylov, let's go.
Kopylov against Cesar Almeida. Almeida, a guy that, like I said, actually had a kickboxing win over Alex Bahia. 5-0 in his MMA career and stuff. But Kopylov, you know, it was the first round, though.
Yeah.
The first round was good.
It was good.
I thought Kopylov really fought smart, did a couple takedowns, got up, didn't, you know, I was like, why are you getting up, man? But okay. You know, and then later on in the fight, the third round, please, I need to take you down and keep you down, yeah, and stay down. But there's no way that it should have been a split decision.
No, they had some bad decisions throughout the night.
Yeah.
You know, they'll get it together one day. But
one day.
John, who was the ref that was didn't stop with the eye poke and didn't?
Casper Oliver.
Okay, so Casper Oliver.
Casper.
Casper?
G-A-S.
Oh, G. Gasper. Yeah. Gasper. Like gasping for air.
Yes.
Got it. I guess, look, we've had this conversation quite a bit about judging and reffing and this and that. And I feel like I'm going to bring it up now just because I will forget about it later. And this is something we should talk about.
Time to rag on.
Yeah. No, I'm not ragging on him. I'm simply saying, okay, like, he obviously doesn't do a lot of top level fights. Okay. So when you get to the big show, you're doing the top level fights. Fighter gets poked in the eye. No, keep fighting. Okay.
That was in the Randy Brown fight.
Yes, it was in the Randy Brown fight. But my point is that commentary was complaining about that. Obviously, fighters are going to complain about that. But look, sure, you guys should understand the difference having somebody like him. And I'm not saying he did a bad job the whole night, just in a couple scenario situations. But
no, he did a pretty bad job most of the night.
John, I was trying to be nice, John. But then you take.
He let a headbutt go.
I know.
I mean, what?
And that's what I was trying to remember. I was trying to remember there was another incident with him in it, and it was the headbutt in the girl in the female fight. Yep. And then you, like, when you think about it, these fighters are not fighters. These, we complain about the ones like Jason Herzog and Mike Beltran and Mark Goddard. What are we complaining about, guys?
Hello.
If these guys don't come to the show, you're going to have more of those guys. Like, you've got, like, it takes time. Like, I can't. So be very, stop complaining about the reffing. Stop complaining about the judging.
It's also, I talk to you all the time about the more repetitions you do, the better off you're going to be. And then everyone has a bad night, you know, and this was his bad night. It was his bad night. You know, I've watched him referee before, and he's gone through it and never and not had any problems. And this one, he just made bad decisions throughout. And it was like, what are you doing? Mm-hmm. But it's a bad night, you know, and it's one of those, you know, it's okay to sit there and say, all right, you know what? if you're the New Jersey State Athletic Commission, you can say, you know what, the next show we're going to sit you down. I'm not going to let you. You're going to show me in some of the smaller regional shows that it was just a bad night, and you're not going to make those same mistakes. And then we'll talk about, you know, the next time the UFC comes here about possibly putting you on that card.
Is he?
That's what happens.
Is he in New Jersey? Is he only working for them, or does he?
Yes.
Okay. So he doesn't work in other states then.
No, he might work in New York, possibly. I don't know if they licensed him or not, but most of the time he's in New Jersey.
Interesting. Next fight.
Jelton Almeida. Jelton Almeida against Romanoff. This is the one you want to talk about. I'm going to let you go.
What is there to talk about, John? The fight was over quickly.
I don't know. What is there to talk about?
Because I was listed right here, John. Anyways, look, this was my first selection on my Punk's Parlay, and then I had Randy Brown as my second one, and then Paulo Costa blew it all for me. But look, I had it going for a bit. I was feeling good because I was watching yours. Your picks weren't doing all that great. So I was like, okay, my picks were doing a little bit better. And so, you know, anyway.
I went 3-2.
Yeah, 3-2. I didn't pick that many. I only picked 3.
Yeah.
So, overall, just look. He was able to take Curtis Blaze down. What made you think he wasn't going to take Romanoff down? That's one. Yeah. Two is, look, once these heavyweights get tired, in a 3-round fight after one or two takedowns, they're not getting back up. So, Jelton Almeida, all he had to do was get another takedown in the second round. I think he would have dominated the fight. So, the fact that he got the submission just kind of eased our pain. We didn't have to watch two guys lay around on each other.
You know, there's something that happened during that fight that you see all the time. I used to see as a referee all the time. And it's when every time you see it, I go, you're going to lose. And it was Jelton ends up taking Romanoff's back. Okay. Romanoff goes and Jelton throws in the choke, but it's on the chin. And Romanoff's just sitting there, you know, getting crushed a little bit. But he lets go of it, and basically, and the Romanoff did the normal. And it's like, I don't know why guys do it, because every time it shows me you're not freaking in this. You're not going to get this. I hate to say it. You're dicking around instead of getting yourself out of the problem. Quit dicking around and start fucking getting out of the problem. Mm-hmm. And he did it, and I went, he's going to lose. He's going to get submitted. Hmm. And shortly thereafter, right away, I was like, well, there it is again.
It's those guys.
Happens all the time.
Yeah, it's the ego. The ego gets in the way, John. It's the ego. All right, let's go next fight.
Grant Dawson against Joe Selicki. I'll tell you what, you know, this is one of those ones you're looking and you go, you know, we talk about people fighting off of their back all the time. And hey, look, in MMA, unless you are a submission machine, and I'm not saying Selicki's not a good jiu-jitsu guy. He's got very good ability to control, to keep someone from hurting, but you got to throw on submissions.
Yeah.
You got to be on the offensive, because everything you're doing is defensive and you're getting nothing for it. You've got to be offensive. And it was like, I'm just watching, you know, you want to talk about, you know, rinse, wash, and repeat. Mm-hmm. This was one of those fights.
Grant Dawson seems like he's just elevating his game right now. Everything about him seems like he's gotten so much better. I mean, he's just I think with Mike Brown, the team over there, I think he's just finding his groove. He's just figuring himself out.
But
he's good, man.
Yeah, but let me ask you this. In looking at this, so, you know, Joe Selicki is known as a ground fighter. Mm-hmm. He's known as a guy that's a jiu-jitsu guy. And Grant Dawson has got good stand-up. Why didn't he keep this thing standing more than he? Because he was the one doing the takedowns.
Yeah. I think once you feel someone, like every person feels different on the ground. Like you might be a good grappler, but I've trained with some black belts that I'm like, oh, I got this. And these are guys that have placed it, you know, worlds and like they're, it's like, I don't know, but you're like, oh, I got this. And, you just feel comfortable. Some guys, and there's guys that I've trained with that were black belts. They were just like, there was one, there was a guy named Polito, and he was, Polito means toothpick, I think, in Portuguese. I was like, this guy, I was training with Lucas Leitch, Leo Vieira, Buchecha, and him, Polito, and another guy named LaPella. all five guys, world class. Paulito was the skinniest, kind of twiggier one. You know, like he was real skinny. I did good against Lucas. Did good against, you know, LaPella. Was doing good, like holding my own. Man, this guy's like, man, this guy is tiny. He wasted no energy and fucking swept me with the same sweep every single time we started training. Touch hands, got ready to train, same sweep every single time. Like clockwork. I had no answer for him. He rolled me up like into a Tootsie Roll. Jacked me up. Yeah. Just those guys, you get into their guard and like, man, you don't feel safe at all. And then you get into other guys' guard that are world class as well. And you're like, oh, I feel comfortable here.
I'm all right.
Just depends on how they gather the arms, how they, you know, keep their high guard, low guard, whatever it is. It just depends on the fighter. It depends on the athlete. So get it. And it makes it easy. It's easy to take you down. It's easier to get to a position where I feel safe and controlled. I'm just going to keep doing it. Rinse, wash, repeat.
That's it. That's
next fight. Was.
Jake Matthews taking on Phil Rowe. This is what cracked me up because, you know, commentary started out all about Phil Rowe. First off, it was basketball. DC playing basketball, which is hysterical.
Yeah.
Because, you know, obviously, you know, he ain't getting high up on the backboard.
No. Did you see the videos of Islam making fun of him in the belly?
Oh, yes.
Oh, man.
Oh, yes.
Bro, I mean, but look, this lets you know how close of a family everyone is. Brother, I care for you. You need to, like, you have to take care of yourself. Like, you have family, kids. Like, come on. It's important to take care of yourself. DC, you got to fix that.
Well, I guess he's playing basketball with certain people, and Phil Rowe's one of them and stuff, but it quickly changed. You know, Phil comes out, he's looking sharp. Jake Matthews figured out quickly, hey, this is one of those fights when we're talking about, hey, all the way out or all the way in, I've got to crush that space. And when I crush that space, I get busy. I go after him and I start throwing big shots to make him pay. And that's what Jake Matthews did. He did all of these, you know, moments where he crushed the space quickly and big time brawling attack. It wasn't a whole lot of, you know, technical, you know, fighting as far as, oh, look at that, you know, beautiful setup and the lateral movement. No, he was coming straight into him and crushing, taking away Phil Rowe's actual athleticism and length and making it difficult for him to fight at that distance. Mm-hmm. And it was a smart fight by Jake Matthews.
I agree. Jake Matthews fought a very good fight. Smart, just composed, stay relaxed. He looked good. You know, he had a tendency sometimes of like overdoing things, pushing too hard sometimes instead of like letting it develop in front of him. I thought he fought a good fight tonight. Next fight.
Basil Haviz against Mickey Gall. I actually didn't thought this was a great fight.
This was a really good fight. They both
fought their asses off. I thought Mickey Gall looked great. I thought he took some big shots. He got hurt a little bit. He fought his way back. I thought Haviz, he looked good. You know, he sometimes a little too strong-minded in the, I'm going to, and come forward. It's like, stop that. You know, that's not smart fighting, but you know what? He got the win. I thought it was a really good fight between the two of them. I was really impressed, you know, and I know Mickey lost, but I was really impressed with his stand-up and what Killcliff has done with him. Mm-hmm. Robbie Lawler was in his corner and stuff and everything, so he's really improved in the stand-up.
Yeah.
And it's making a difference in his ability to fight MMA.
Yeah, I thought he looked phenomenal, actually, after the first round. I thought he looked good, you know? I think had he just had a little bit, I would say a little bit more balls. Not in a bad way. Like, he bit down on the mouthpiece a little bit more, I think he would have had a little bit more success. Because he was winning those exchanges.
A lot of them.
And he just wasn't, for me, I felt like it was whoever punched last kind of landed the harder shot. So you just got to land that last shot every single time. Because he had rocked, how do you say his name?
Haviz.
He had rocked him a couple of times. And I was like, okay, I see what you're doing. This is good. Yeah. But then also, too, you got to mix in a lot more wrestling to keep them guessing, to hesitate, get them hesitating a little bit more. But I think overall, I thought Mickey Gall looked really good. Really good.
I was really impressed by him. I really was. I thought it was the best I ever saw Mickey Gall look in a fight. You know, other than when he wins and, you know, by submission, that's great, but really looked good. Then we had Alina Perez against Jocelyn Edwards, a fight that they supposedly did not like each other, but in the end, they loved each other.
The twerking queen.
Yeah, the twerk.
Hey,
she wants, you want to twerk? Twerk away.
Yeah, whatever. Get your followers. Away. Get after it. What'd you think of the fight?
I thought interesting in the fact that at times, you know, Perez, I mean, just the, it drives me crazy when I see people doing things. It's like, how do you not know how to stop that?
Yeah. Same sweep over and over and over.
And the same sweep. Oh, yeah. It's like, come on. Yeah. You're going to get hit with that again? Yes, you are. Okay. And it was just like, Jocelyn Edwards seemed like the stronger fighter, but didn't have the technique that Perez did. Perez, her judo was the difference in the fight, I thought. Mm-hmm. You know, she used the hip toss multiple times. She used a harago. She used the uchimata. She did some nice, you know, takedowns, and most of the time held position, and then Jocelyn Edwards would out athlete her and strength her right off.
Yeah.
But, you know, she got the win, and I thought she deserved it.
Yeah, I thought it was a scrappy little fight back and forth. Good exchanges, you know, on the reversals in the wrestling and the up from the ground. Good, nicely done. What's your take on that headbutt? Would you have taken a point?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yes. Look, there's certain things, and you can take a look at what happened and how it happens, because she's being held. Right. And then she goes and she comes up and, you know, brings her weight down. Okay. What does it do right away to Perez? You know, and you can see the lump. Mm-hmm. And it's like, okay, well, you just created a situation to where now you've created an unfair advantage. You made it to where now she doesn't want to be hit in that area because it's sore and it hurts and it's puffing up. And all these things. So I'm going to have to try to level this out because you were an idiot. The other part of me taking the point is you were an idiot. You know, you can't do that. Yeah. So I'm going to have to show you, all right, you're never going to get away with that while I'm the guy that's in here with you. So I would have taken the point.
Interesting. All right, guys, that's going to wrap up our show for the weekend, and hopefully you guys enjoyed it. Check out the live reaction I did as well. That is going to be down below, I believe. And George, you got anything else for us to talk about? Nothing? It's 3 a.m, guys. We're going to wrap
Come on, Big George. We'll talk all day.
You missed the Bronze Bomber versus
That's right. We got to talk about. Hello. Jeez, thank John. You very much. You see?
Jeez, John.
Yeah, you know, this is why you're here, George. Yeah. We try to tell him that, hey, he's got to be up on these things, but no. He wants to leave because he wants to sleep. While Zhang knocks out Wilder. Did you watch it?
I did not watch it. I just watched the knockout, John.
Okay.
Tell me. Talk to me, Goose.
You know, 5-round fight, you know, in the end is what it took. Wilder never really seemed that comfortable in there. And it's, I think there's that thing about size. He's not comfortable, and he's tall, but he's super thin. You know, he's rail thin, and when he faces someone that is his size in height and heavier, he has a lot of problems keeping that person off of him. And he ends up working pretty hard. And, you know, he got hit with it was a right hook. You know, since Zhang goes southpaw a lot of times. But he got hit with that right hook. You know, when he turned and started walking away, it's like, uh-oh. You know, and then he kind of turned around. He ran right into the next one and down. And it was a good stoppage. He was wobbling forward. You know, you look and you go, Deontay, there comes that point where, you know, instead of being, you know, the guy that, you know, wants to see the highlights, you're the guy that people are watching be the highlight. And happens to everyone and stuff, and he, you know, he can still fight, but he's gonna have to figure out he's got to change his style, he's got to change what he's doing, because now people, that blueprint is out there on beating him.
Yep.
And you're seeing people really, you know, Joseph Parker beat him, now Zhang beat him, and you know, it's gonna end up happening with the other heavyweights based upon the blueprint on how to beat him is out there now.
Yeah,
he's got to figure out a way to make it to where it doesn't work.
He has such a gift with that power.
That right hand.
Yeah. He just sometimes takes forever to get to it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I mean, when he fought Ortiz, right? Ortiz didn't knock Ortiz out until the last round. I think is what it was.
No, 10th round.
10th round? Okay.
10th round.
Was it a 10-round fight, though?
12-round fight, I think.
Wasn't a title fight.
Not the 10th. Yeah, it was.
Was it? Okay.
Yeah.
It was. Anyways, yeah. But anyways, he knocked him out. I thought it was the last round. Anyways. But yeah, just crazy. Just like he's got the gift. He's got the gift of power, you know, and I'm jealous and envious of those motherfuckers.
He put Fury down in the 12th round.
He did. He did. We all thought he was fucking the Undertaker when he got up.
The Undertaker.
Just crazy. I heard the announcements, or not the announcement, I heard the announcer saying like, oh, this could be the way that he goes out. This could be the wrap of his career or something like that.
No.
Like,
I don't think so.
I don't think it will be either.
I don't think it should be.
What's that?
I don't think it should be, but I do think he has to take care of the situations that people are now presenting to him based upon, all right, we have a plan on how to beat you.
Yeah.
And it's working. It's worked for Joseph Parker. You know, take the Tyson Fury fights out of there. But the Joseph Parker and now this fight, yeah, they're both different fighters, but they both had similar game plans and how to attack him, force him into certain things. And so that's working. You're going to have to figure it out. But you know, the other part is that I really think the heavyweight division is as good as it's been for a while, you know, with people with name, you know, Anthony Joshua is a great heavyweight. And now you got, you know,
Usyk and Fury.
He's the undisputed, and Fury's still there. And you got guys like Joseph Parker, and you got Zhang, you know. And, you know, I think Joseph Parker had just beat Zhang. I think that was Zhang's first loss, was Joseph Parker recently. But, you know, Zhang is good, you know. You know, I don't know if he's related to Wei Li. They're different sizes.
He's such a smart ass.
Well, Zhang, you know.
Yeah.
But he's good. He's pretty goddamn nimble for a big man. He throws a beautiful fucking jab, and he's got power in his hands.
So. Obviously.
Yeah.
I mean, he hit him with the big shot, and then he followed up with a crushing shot.
Oh, dude!
And Wilder turned right into it.
Beak. Yep. Well, the one you don't see.
Yeah.
Is the one that hurts you the most, and it did.
All right, guys. Hey, that's going to wrap up our show for tonight. Hope you guys enjoy this. Look, we did the best we could to get this thing out to you as soon as we can.
The best we could.
Keto George is going to try to drop this by, I think, 9 a.m. Eastern, 6 a.m. Pacific time. So hopefully he can get this thing done tonight. He's got to send us over some clips, too, so we can get this thing posted up for you guys. But, hey, we appreciate you guys so much. Hope you guys enjoyed UFC 302 and hashtag and still weighing in podcast and still hashtag Islam Makhachev. John, take us away, buddy.
For everyone out there, thank you for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed. Have a great Sunday, and we will see you.